1700 to noon, midwives opened up schools with more official training programs. And as waves of European immigrants came over to America in the following century, they brought these skills with them as they settled in the northern states. While in the American South, enslaved black women were forced to attend to the deliveries and care of white children and were torn from their own families. And they continued working as skilled midwives long after slavery ended.
They were often referred to as granny midwives. They tended to be senior, older members of their community who had themselves already given birth and were viewed with respect among their community.
But in the 1900s, doctors started to edge midwives out of the delivery room. And they made a convincing argument.
Birth might look simple. It may have been going on for centuries, but in fact, it was a pathological event that requires medical intervention.
Like a procedure called the episiotomy. During birth, it's common for a woman to tear her vaginal opening. Then in the 1920s, doctors started proactively cutting the opening instead.
And I think the idea was that that would be easier to sew up. And it turned out that giving people episiotomies makes tearing much worse.
And around that same time, Western doctors also started offering new pain drugs, like one trend that emerged out of Germany called Twilight Sleep.
It was a mixture of heavy narcotics, scopolamine, and morphine. Extremely controversial because it was really dangerous. Many of the women who were behind Twilight Sleep were involved in the suffrage movement, and their argument was that women should have the right to have a painless childbirth.
But the drugs didn't actually get rid of the pain, just the memory of the pain. Women in delivery rooms thrashed violently, screamed. They were often hooded, placed in cage beds while they labored.
The birthing experience differed enormously based on where you lived, your class background, and the color of your skin. There's a theory that the more civilized a race or a culture is, the more difficulty the women have experiencing childbirth. And so anesthesia was also required to make sure that they could get through the process. Working class women, women of color, immigrant women, no problem. Babies could just pop out. It was the over-civilized upper-middle-class women that needed help.
That stereotype lives on today, and it's one reason black women in the UK are 5 times more likely to die in childbirth than white women. And they're 3 times more likely in the US, where disparities exist even at the same income level.
Biggest issue, they're not being heard. When women have said, I'm in pain, the understanding stereotype of women of color, that they're not really quite in pain the way they are.
So back in the 1950s, while many black women didn't get pain medication, even when they needed it, white women started to speak out about being over-medicated. In 1958, the Ladies' Home Journal published an investigation, Cruelty in Maternity Wards, chronicling the abuses women faced in hospitals. One woman wrote in, they give you drugs whether you want them or not, and strap you down like an animal.
Women start reacting to what they believe to be absolutely horrific birth experiences. They get angry and think they have missed out on what should be the most incredible moment of their lives. And that somehow that gets completely lost in the process of medicalizing birth.
One of the most influential voices in the grassroots movement was Ina May Gaskin, a midwife turned activist. In her 1975 book, Spiritual Midwifery, she said that when women are empowered to birth without drugs or interventions, birth is a spiritual experience that each woman deserves in a safe and comfortable setting.
There were a lot of hippie women involved in the natural childbirth movement, but there were also middle-class suburban housewives. There were people on all sides of the political spectrum that simply thought, I don't need to be knocked unconscious in order to give birth. I am capable of doing it.
And by that time, there was a hot new drug in town, epidurals. Scientists discovered that injecting anesthesia into a certain spot in the spine called the epidural space stopped pain signals traveling from the spine to the brain. The entire lower half of a woman's body would go numb within minutes while she remained fully alert.
That was great. It was very nice. No regrets on the epidural. I couldn't feel my body from the waist down. And I knew at that point it was one of the best decisions I've ever made in my life. I was like...
The World Health Organization says epidurals are perfectly safe for healthy women in labor. But of course,
half your body is numb, so the pushing stage of labor tends to be a bit longer, maybe on average about 20 minutes. You have less control over the bladder and maybe less easy to walk around afterwards.
Another medical intervention that's been surging in popularity, C-sections. That's how one-fifth of babies around the world are now delivered, twice as many as in 2000. In some countries, they account for more than half of all births, like Egypt, the Dominican Republic, and Brazil, where the overall rate is 55%. But in private hospitals, where doctors are being paid per service, not per hour of work, it's 83%.